Thank you very much. As you can probably realise, we are going to give a joint presentation. So I shall be starting and Alan will take on the second part of the presentation. And as you may have heard in our introduction, we have both between us many years' experience of working with the RSPB, that's the Royal Society for the Protection of Birds in the UK, which is the world's largest membership conservation organisation. In my case, I worked as head of trading, where I set up the trading organisation that enabled the RSPB to trade bird food and bird care products throughout the UK and further afield to plough the proceeds of that directly into its conservation work. Alan will be explaining his role with the RSPB when he takes up the second part of the presentation. But despite that, we both gave up our jobs with the RSPB to dedicate a single year to travelling the world. And our objective was to try and set a new world record for the highest number of bird species seen in a single calendar year. That record had previously been set back in 1989 by American birder Jim Clements, and he achieved a total of 3,662 species. A staggering total, I'm sure you'll agree, but we felt it was time that a country other than America held this title, so I'm sorry, Ted, we decided to challenge. Now, some may say that global travel and conservation don't sit very well together, but it did in fact allow us to experience firsthand some fascinating and fantastic ecotourism projects around the world. And ever since our year, we've been travelling the world and telling people about some of our experiences. And that's exactly what we'd like to do today, and share with you some of the best experiences we encountered. Our year started in America on the 1st of January 2008 in Arizona. And it seemed appropriate that the very first bird we saw was state bird for Arizona, the cactus wren. However, we very quickly moved on to Ecuador, which was always going to be a very key country for us in our race to see this huge number of birds. Ecuador has a bird species list of over 1,600 species. However, we were devastated to see that even in areas of so-called protection, such as these national parks, there was large-scale illegal logging operations being undertaken as vast tracts of forest were being cut down. What we had decided to do before we left on our big tour was to support this particular charitable organization, which is called the Mindo Cloud Forest Foundation. And it's an Ecuadorian organization which works very closely with Ecuadorian landowners to support them as they either work to maintain pristine forest habitat or to restore degraded forest that has been used for farming, to restore it back to its previous condition, such as you can see here at Milpi Bird Sanctuary. They also work to put in trails that can be followed by birders, enabling visitors to get deep into parts of the forest they mightn't otherwise be able to reach. And a network of these reserved areas have been linked together in an eco-route, as they call it. It's a corridor of protected habitat which acts as an enlarged reserve for the wildlife that you can enjoy there. So you develop these areas of protected habitat where the wildlife can thrive, and visitors like ourselves travel a long distance in order to get into these areas which have such a rich biodiversity. While you're there, you're staying with locals, you're eating in the local restaurants, you're staying with local villagers or local hotels. So the money that you are spending is going directly back into the local community so that they're able to make that direct connection with the value of the species that they are seeing in the habitat around them that we're sharing with you now. And the visitors who come from all over the world to enjoy the wildlife spectacle, making that clear link between conservation and ecotourism. The next key country for us was Ethiopia, an incredibly bird-rich country. We were privileged to spend 26 days here, and we encountered over 575 species. It has a large number of migrant birds that we Europeans are more familiar with seeing in the spring and summer months, but it also has a large number of endemic species, such as these taxonomic oddities, Stresemann's bush crows. Other endemics that we enjoyed included thick-billed raven, which is apparently the largest-billed passerine in the world. We also encountered spot-billed lapwing. It's spot-breasted lapwing, I'm sorry, which we encountered up in the Bali Mountains and the high altitude. This country is known as the roof of Africa for very good reason. And Rouget's rail, which has to be one of the most confiding rails I think I have ever met. Wherever we stopped to bird, we were immediately surrounded by interested local villagers, and we would always make a point of sharing what we could see with them. So we'd encourage them to look through our scope and our binoculars to see the birds that we were enjoying. And it was fascinating to see how they could really relate to the birds around them. Whenever we got our field guides out, whenever we pointed to a particular species, they immediately identified what it was and could point us straight to the immediate area where we could find it. So they really are used to accepting and noticing the wildlife around them. One particular place we stayed, and I think this is an example of perhaps where ecotourism could be developed further, is the town of Negeli. It's deep in the heartland. It is a very poor town. It is one that struggles for water. While we were there, there had been no water supply for this particular town for some months on end. So any water brought into the town was bought by Bowser. It was a very scarce commodity. However, this is also the town that any bird watcher who wants to see two particular key species has to visit and has to stay at. One of these species is Prince Rospoli's turaco. It is a range-restricted endemic and a beautiful bird. It has an interesting history. First discovered by Prince Rospoli in the 1800s, unfortunately, he was killed before able to make any notes about where he had encountered this particular species, and so it was lost to science until it was rediscovered in the 1940s. However, it is a key bird on any world birder's target list, and birders will travel for many miles to see it, staying at Negeli. However, even more critical is the critically endangered Liben or Sidamo lark, which unfortunately has the pride of place as being the rarest species we encountered on our big year of travel. This lark has apparently only 250 mature adults left as its entire global population. It lives in a very restricted area of prairie grassland, which has been much degraded through overgrazing and through encroachment of local homesteads. And this seems to be a prime example of where, by building in the support of the local residents and making them appreciate just how important and how rare this bird on their very doorstep is, might be the key way of saving this bird from imminent extinction. That's the word I'm looking for. Thank you, Ellen. From there we moved to Ghana, and I'd like to show you an example of how this really can work in practice. We drove to a very remote part of Ghana where we drove into this very rural area and to one particular small settlement where we were greeted very enthusiastically by the local children. We then engaged the village elders to take us on certain trails through, and shade trees have been planted to allow the seed bed that has lain for a long time in the ground to generate and for secondary growth to start to appear. And it doesn't take long. As soon as you start to create a habitat, wildlife will immediately move in and take advantage of the opportunity presented to them. So masked ducks can be a very difficult species to encounter elsewhere in Brazil. But here at Dregua, they're very close. You can take fantastic photos of them from close up as they enjoy the man-made wetland. And in amongst the secondary growth, so you can enjoy close-up views of birds like this beautiful helmeted manakin. And in some of the upland areas, minute areas of the original rainforest remain, and you can encounter birds like the shrike-like Cantinga. But of course, it isn't just the bird species that are protected when the habitat is protected. The whole ecosystem is bound up in this protection. And so mammals, insects, and birds all thrive alike as the habitat is protected for them. I'll now hand over to Alan, who will take you through some of the projects that we encountered in the second half of our year.
Thank you very much, Ruth. That's great. Thank you. A round of applause as well. That's very kind. Thank you. Yes, as Ruth mentioned, both of us are former RSPB members of staff, and my role with the RSPB was actually as a nature reserve manager, and I worked in North Wales, where we protected a small wetland area So back to our travels, and we headed off again, crossing the Atlantic, and down to Africa again, and to Southern Africa. Some of you might be surprised to see a picture of a penguin on a talk about Southern Africa, but there's a cold current of water that wells up from the Antarctic that reaches the southern tip of Africa. And this provides bitterly cold water, but it also provides huge amounts of nutrients, which then provide huge amounts of fish, which can be then fed on by vast numbers of seabirds, including the African penguin. So offshore from Cape Town, there are huge trawler fleets at work off fishing out here for the rich waters that contain these huge amounts of fish. And as you can see, enormous amounts of seabirds are attracted to these trawlers. This does lead to a conservation problem, and birdwatchers heading out to look at these birds, again, it's a real eco-tourist destination, South Africa. Birders come down to this part of the world, take to the high seas on small boats to witness this wonderful spectacle of seabirds offshore. But there are problems with the fishing fleet, unfortunately. A lot of the fishing fleet's methods is to use long lines with hooks which are baited. Then the seabirds can see the bait in the water, they come down, they grab the bait, and of course, tragically, many of the birds become entangled on the hooks, like this albatross here. And it's been seen that many of the albatross populations are in fast decline due to the long line use and the fact they're being caught on these hooks. So the birdwatchers realised this was a problem, it was highlighted, and BirdLife International, along with local NGOs, launched a project called Save the Albatross. And both Ruth and myself were heavily involved in raising funds for this project with our work with the RSPB. There's some very simple ideas came forward to stop this happening. By flying these tory lines or streamers from the back of the boats, the back of the trawlers, this keeps the birds away from the catch, from the hook, baited hooks long enough to stop the birds taking the hooks and being entangled and obviously dying. So these very simple methods have been put in place, and it's great news now that the albatross population, as the decline is slowing at least and possibly being reversed. So when you get out to these trawler fleets on a small boat, you can encounter some wonderful seabirds very close up. There's only one problem with this for me personally, as I get very, very seasick indeed, whereas Ruth enjoys being out on the open sea wonderfully. Within an hour of me being on the boat, I was very ill indeed. And it wasn't long before I was being sick, and Ruth was enjoying a wonderful time in the sunshine watching these beautiful birds. So every now and again, someone would grab hold of my little remaining hair, hold my head up and say, "Open your eyes now." And at this point, I would open my eyes and see one of these wonderful seabirds just passing within a few yards of the boat. So it was one of those heaven and hell experiences for me. But very encouraging to be out on the high seas and seeing the conservation methods that Ruth and I had worked so hard to promote back in the UK, actually in action, and see these albatrosses being saved. So we then switched continents again and headed off to Australia, a brand new continent for both of us. So the birds were not only going to be new for our year list, they were also going to be new for our life list as well. And there are some wonderful birds in Australia. But we did take a few minutes out to do some cultural things as well on our fast-paced birding tour. We stood and watched the sunset at Ayers Rock with 5,000 Japanese tourists. We also encountered some of these guys. This is a koala, and koalas don't do a lot. They spend about 20 hours a day digesting their food and about a mere 4 hours a day feeding. This animal was just doing just that, lounging around on a tree, but somehow Ruth managed to take 186 pictures of this particular animal. So if you ever need a picture of a koala bear, do let us know, we have some to spare. Moving up into the rainforest area of Australia, this is a site that we love to bird in. This is O'Reilly's Rainforest Resort. It's a beautiful picturesque area which has an excellent ecotourism structure. Here many of the birds are attracted into the beautiful grounds around the lodge, where many of the visitors only visit this particular area around the lodge to feed the birds and have close-up experiences of seeing these beautiful coloured parrots that are encountered in Australia. Some of the birds, as you can see, can be quite tame indeed. But the great thing about this place is the people visit the site spending their tourist dollars at the resort. But in the immediate vicinity of the resort is a large area of pristine forest, and the money generated from the ecotourism goes to protect these wonderful forest areas, which include some wonderful birding, such as this particularly iconic species, the log runner, which we were lucky enough to see in this protected forest. But the whole protection scheme was down to the ecotourism of the resort. Of course, on a birding tour, it's important to be with the right tour group. As you can see, this group of bird watchers is completely missing the brush turkey that is just very quietly tiptoeing behind the group there. And of course, it was in Australia in late October, the 31st of October, that we actually broke the world record for the number of species seen in a particular year. So this is the blue bonnet parrot, the very individual bird that broke that world record. So we are now on 3,663 species, one more than the previous record. But there was no way that we were going to give up our birding adventure. We still had 2 months of the year left. So we headed from Australia via Malaysia up into India. And we spent a whole month in this wonderful country, burning very, very fast pace and very hard. And we have a huge vote of thanks to our great friend, Peter Lobo, who is here at the conference with us, who helped us enormously throughout our entire time in India. And as you can see, we had to really suffer in India. This is having breakfast by the Brahmaputra River, and Peter and his team provided wonderful facilities for us the whole time during our whole month in India. This was a very common occurrence. We'd come round the corner in the morning after our early morning birding session, and Peter's team had laid out this wonderful food, and we were able to enjoy wonderful Indian cuisine throughout our whole month. And of course, some wonderful birds to add to our list. This is our great Thickney, which we were privileged to see again this morning on our outing from the coach trip. We also visited some quite remote areas of northern India, which again was wonderful to see some ecotourism projects here. This is the Mishmi Hills, where again birders are visiting this area and helping the local people by providing income for local people to preserve this beautiful forest in this Mishmi Hills area. And it's a very iconic area indeed, with some wonderful bird life. This is the endemic Mishmi Wren Babbler, which again is hanging on in a very small area of forest, which is now being protected by the local people, which is being supported by visiting birders. And some of the bird life you have in northern India is very strange and bizarre indeed, such as this particular favourite of ours, slender-billed scimitar babbler. And of course, the wonderful thing about birding in northern India is not only the wonderful bird life, but the spectacular scenery wherever you go. And we really were thrilled to see the Himalayan backdrop wherever we went with Peter. We also spent some time at the Lama camp at Eagle's Nest Sanctuary, which was referred to briefly in one of the talks yesterday. And again, this is a fantastic eco project in the forest here. Again, visiting birders coming in, providing income for local people to help provide these camps, provide the food and infrastructure that birdwatchers need, so we can enjoy such bizarre, weird birds as the Bhuvan Leo Chikla, which is only recently discovered in northeast India. And again, some of the bird life here was absolutely staggering. Again, a favourite of ours, the Whiskered Euhena. We also visited an even more remote area in Nagaland, and not too far from the Bhutanese-Chinese border in northeast India. And again, here we were able to stay in local villages with local people and enjoyed their great hospitality here. And it was wonderful to see how welcoming the local people were in this part of India, welcoming us literally into their homes. We stayed with the families and enjoyed the wonderful bird life in this area, including this weird species, the fire-tailed Mysornis. So, just to summarise our talk, what are the keys to successful ecotourism? Well, first of all, of course, you need some wildlife to show people. It doesn't have to be particularly spectacular, like the wonderful cranes we have here, which we saw on this particular trip. A wildlife spectacle can mean many things to different people. I think it's important to realise that it doesn't have to be anything rare or particularly unusual. A first person's encounter with wildlife can be something so simple and so easy to see as a common bird if you see it well. And that can spark an interest in people's interest in conservation and wildlife. This is the nature reserve where I work in North Wales, and the visitor centre that was able to build during my time there. And again, it's important if you are going to invite tourists into an area to be ready to receive them and have the right things in place, to have the wonderful accommodation you have here, and of course the food, the guides and drivers, everything is needed for the tourists when they arrive. But perhaps even more important than that, it's important to have people that are enthusiastic about the place they live and the place they work and the wildlife they see. And I think that's something drawing from our RSPB experience, which is very important indeed. It's having people to meet and greet people and enthuse them about the wildlife. And I think it's so much better if a human face enthuses you about wildlife. It's very nice to look in a book, very nice to look on the internet, but so much more personal is the experience if you have a human face to tell you and show you the wildlife spectacle on your doorstep, and particularly if that person is local to the area. It's also a very important thing, and again, the RSPB is very good at encouraging this, is to get the local community involved in any ecotourist project. Make sure the local people that live near the site benefit from the activities of the conservation work going on and benefit from the people visiting the area. And this is certainly something that we've seen at first hand at this wonderful conference. Of course, once you've got your ecotourism set up, you've got your wildlife, you've got your infrastructure, it's then very important to let people know what you have. And I must admit, we've been very surprised how wonderful the bird life here is in Gujarat. Not having visited this area before, we knew little about it. So again, important, once you have the wildlife ecotourism in place, is to get the message out there to the wide world. Let people know what you're doing, let people know how important ecotourism is for your community. And it's very easy to do that these days with the World Wide Web. It's so much easier now to get messages out there and spread the word to the wider birding community. So we finished our year at the end of December 2008 on a staggering 4,341 species. And it was a wonderful adventure, and we were very sad to see it come to an end. If you'd like to find out more about the biggest twitch, you can log on to our website, or of course you can also read our recently published book. So thank you very much indeed for your time, and thank you very much for inviting us over to Gujarat.